physiological changes during pregnancy. Pregnancy or gestation is defined as a physiological process of developing a fetus within the maternal body. In order to achieve a successful pregnancy, a major adaptation in a maternal anatomy, physiology, and metabolisms are necessary. These adaptations play an important role to meet the increasing demands of the growing fetus. It helps to maintain the pregnancy and also helps to prepare a mother for delivery and breastfeeding. Understanding this physiological change is very important to differentiate from the pathology. These changes are mainly mediated by the hormonal changes during pregnancy, and it affects nearly every organ system. For this part, we will see the changes in the cardiovascular system, hematologic changes, and metabolic changes. So let us start from the cardiovascular system. In order to maximize oxygen delivery to both mother and the fetus, some of the most profound physiological changes takes place in the cardiovascular system. So let us see the changes in the anatomy of the heart. The heart is displaced to the left upward and rotate along its long axis. This is because of the elevation of the diaphragm and the change in the architecture of the rib cage. Because of this anatomic change, the point of maximal impulse on physical examination is displaced to the left side, and the radiographic imagings are changed. Like some of the changes on imagings are straightening of the left side of the heart, increased prominence of pulmonary conus, and increased cardiac silhouette. But there is no significant change on the cardiothoracic ratio. The overall heart size is also increased during pregnancy by approximately 12%. This increment is due to eccentric hypertrophy. When we said eccentric hypertrophy, the volume of the heart chambers are increased, but there is no significant change on the wall thickness. This eccentric hypertrophy is due to increased blood volume during pregnancy and increased afterload later in pregnancy. This eccentric hypertrophy normally resolves within 6 months after delivery. Cardiac output. As you know, it is a product of stroke volume and heart rate. In a singleton pregnancy, cardiac output increased by 30 to 50% above the non-pregnant value. In twin pregnancy, additional 20% increment than the singleton one. It begins to rise by 5 weeks of gestation, and the exact gestational age where the cardiac output peaks is controversial, but most agreed it peaks at 25 to 30 weeks of gestation. But in the third trimester of pregnancy, there is a little or no change in the cardiac output. This increased cardiac output is due to increment of both heart rate and the stroke volume. The heart rate increased by around 17%, like 50 to 20 beats per minute. It starts to rise by 5 weeks of gestation and peaks at 32 weeks. Stroke volume also increased. It begins to increase by 8 weeks, it peaks at 20 weeks of gestation, and it fails starting from 32 weeks of gestation. The overall increment of the stroke volume is 20 to 30%. So, most of increase in cardiac output is directed to the uterus, placenta, and the breast. In the first trimester of pregnancy and before pregnancy, the uterus receive 2 to 3% of overall cardiac output, and the breast receive 1% of the cardiac output. But at term, the uterus receives 17% of the cardiac output, that is 450 to 650 ml per minute, and the breast receives 2% of the cardiac output. This increment of the cardiac output during pregnancy is in the expense of decreased the fraction of cardiac output to the splenic bed and the skeletal muscles. Otherwise, the cardiac output to the other organs were not significantly affected during pregnancy. Cardiac output during pregnancy is dependent on the maternal position. It is higher in knee chest position, followed by lateral recumbent position. In a supine position, it is decreased by 10 to 30%. In a standing position, it is decreased by 22%. This positional decrement of the cardiac output during pregnancy is due to compression of the inferior vena cava by the gravid uterus, especially after 24 weeks of gestation, and the effect of the gravity in standing position mainly. Understanding this positional effect of the cardiac output during pregnancy is very important, especially while we resuscitate a pregnant woman in hypotensive state, and then the management of the conservative management of nerve-assuring fetal heart rate pattern. The cardiac output is also significantly increased during labor. This is due to, with the uterine contraction, the blood flow to the uterus will return to the systemic circulation as an autotransfusion. Around 300 to 500 ml of blood with each contraction return to the systemic circulation, leading to increment of the stroke volume. The other important reason for increment of cardiac output during labor is the labor pain and anxiety will significantly increase the heart rate. There is a further increment of the cardiac output in the immediate postpartum period, 10 to 30 minutes after delivery. This is the same explanation with the labor because of autotransfusion, so that the maximum cardiac output is achieved in this immediate postpartum period. It returns to the pre-labor state within 1 hour postpartum. So the other important thing is arterial blood pressure and systemic vascular resistance. Blood pressure is a product of cardiac output and the systemic vascular resistance. Even though the cardiac output is significantly increased during pregnancy, the maternal blood pressure during pregnancy, it decreased early in pregnancy. Starting from 8 weeks of gestation, it reaches a nadir at mid-pregnancy, but starting from the mid-pregnancy, it gradually increased. It reached at term, reached the pre-pregnancy level. Why the blood pressure is decreased? This is mainly because of the decrease in systemic vascular resistance. The systemic vascular resistance began to fail starting from 8 weeks of gestation, reach a nadir at mid-pregnancy. At term, it is 21% lower than the pre-pregnancy value. The exact reason for the fail in systemic vascular resistance is poorly understood, but there are explanations. Because of the vasodilatation mediated by progesterone and nitric oxide, the other explanation is the blunted vascular responsiveness to the pressure effect of norepinephrine and angiotensin II. The mean arterial blood pressure also increased during during labor due to pain and anxiety. So let us see the venous pressure. In the upper extremity, the venous pressure remains unchanged. But in the lower extremity, the venous pressure increased progressively. This increment of venous pressure in the lower extremities in combination with the compression of the inferior vena cava by the gravid uterus, there is a significant, there is increased risk of edema in the lower extremities, varicose vein, increased risk of DVT and hemorrhoids as well. There are symptoms that occur in normal pregnancy that mimic the heart disease. Some of these symptoms are physiologic dyspnea that occurs in normal pregnancy, exercise intolerance, occasional orthopneas, and mild tachycardias can occur in normal pregnancies without heart disease. But the symptoms like hemoptysis, progressive exertional dyspneas, and paroxysmal nocturnal dyspneas are unlikely to occur in normal pregnancies. So there is also physical findings that mimic a normal pregnancy, like there is point of maximal impulse is shifted. There is also mild tachycardia, distended neck vein, especially later in pregnancy, and the third heart sounds are heard in 80 to 90% of the cases because of increased blood flow through the vessels. And the other thing is ejection systolic murmur is heard in 96% of the pregnant woman due to increased blood flow through the pulmonic and aortic valves. So these changes are normally explained during pregnancies. They mimic cardiac disease. So let us see the other change, that's hematologic changes. The maternal blood volume, it is increased during pregnancy. That's in a singleton pregnancy, it is 40 to 50% increased above the non-pregnant value. It starts to rise early in pregnancy. It reaches a plateau starting from 30 to 32 weeks of gestation. This increment of this blood volume during pregnancy plays an important role as a protective effect given the possibility of hemorrhage during pregnancy and at delivery. A larger blood volume also helps to fill the expanded vascular system created by vasodilatations. Here they can prevent, thereby preventing hypotension. So that is very important role, the increment of this blood volume. It results from the expansion of the blood volume as well as RBC expansion. So the plasma volume increased by 50% in a singleton pregnancy. It begins to rise by 6 weeks of gestation. It plateaus after 30 weeks of gestation. But RBC begins to increase by 10 weeks of gestation. It continues to rise until term without plateauing. In a woman who received iron supplementation, the RBC expansion at term it is 18% higher than the non-pregnant value. Those pregnant women who received iron supplementation, the increment is 30%. Those who do not have iron supplementation, 80% expansion. So because of the discrepancy of the plasma volume and RBC expansion, the maternal hemoglobin fails during pregnancy. This results in physiologic anemia of the pregnancy. But this physiologic anemia starts to resolve after 30 to 32 weeks of gestation because of, as we have said, the plasma volume plateau after 30 to 32 weeks of gestation, but the RBC continue increased until term. Let us see about the iron metabolism. Iron absorption is increased during pregnancy because of increased iron requirement. So iron, as you know, iron is absorbed from the duodenum. Around 10% of ingested iron is absorbed from the duodenum. The total iron requirement during pregnancy is about 1,000 milligrams. Of this, 500 milligrams is needed to expand the maternal RBC and 300 milligrams is transferred to the fetus and 200 milligrams is reserved for the daily loss of the mother. The fetus receives iron through active transport via the transferrin receptors. Let us see about the platelet. Platelet, the mean platelet count mildly decreased during pregnancy. So, but the function of the platelet, in contrary to the number, their function is increased in normal pregnancy in order to maintain the hemostasis. Gestational thrombocytopenia occurred in 8% of the gravidas. The platelet count reached to 70 to 150,000 per millimeter cubed. So this doesn't affect the pregnancy outcome and it returned to the normal within 1 to 2 weeks postpartum period. The exact reason for this gestational thrombocytopenia is suspected to be immunologic because of its similarities to that of immune thrombocytopenic purpura. It is also explained to be increased consumptions of the platelet during pregnancy. The leukocyte count, the peripheral WBC count rise progressively during pregnancy. In the first and the second trimester of pregnancy, it reaches up to 10,000. In the third trimester of pregnancy, it reaches up to 12,000. During labor, the WBC count may reach up to 20 to 13,000. So, for this reason, we don't rely on WBC count for the diagnosis of infection during labor. The exact reason for this increment of the leukocyte count is not clear, but it is attributed to be due to steroid and estrogen effect. It returns to the normal within 1 to 2 weeks after delivery. The other is the coagulation system. During pregnancy, the risk of thromboembolic disease is increased by 5 to 6 fold. This is due to the venous stasis, as we said, due to the compression of the inferior vena cava and the pelvic vasculature by the gravid uterus, there is a venous stasis. With venous stasis, there is also vascular endothelial injury. Pregnancy by itself causes hypercoagulable state. This hypercoagulability is said to be a physiologic preparation to prevent peripartum hemorrhage. The hypercoagulability of the pregnancy is mainly because of the increased production of clotting factors, and also there is a decreased, the fibrinolytic activity is decreased, and also the natural inhibitors of coagulation is decreased during pregnancy. So the last is the metabolic changes during pregnancy. The maternal basal metabolic rate rises by 20% in the third trimester of pregnancy. Additional total energy demands of the normal pregnancy is approximately 77,000 kilocalories. This is stratified as you see in the figure. So it is maximum in the third trimester of pregnancy in order to meet the fastest growth of the baby, as you see, 475 kilocalories per day in the third trimester. The average weight gain during pregnancy is 12.5 kg. This is stratified in different parts, as you see. The most important components are the fetus accounts 3.4 kg and the maternal fat store accounts 3.3 kg. The other is the water metabolism. There is a greater water retention in normal pregnancy. It is partly due to the drop in the plasma osmolality. Carbohydrate metabolism. The normal pregnancy is characterized by mild fasting hypoglycemia, postprandial hyperglycemia, and hyperinsulinemia. Pregnancy-induced peripheral insulin resistance is common in pregnancy because of two important reasons. One is the hormonal changes during pregnancy, like estrogen, progesterone, prolactins, and these hormones play an important role for the decreased insulin sensitivity during pregnancy. The other thing is the inflammatory mediators during pregnancy, like tumor necrotic factor alpha, interleukin 2, also plays an important role for decrement of insulin sensitivity. It is said to be 30 to 70% decreased insulin sensitivity late in pregnancy. So let us see the fat metabolism. The pregnancy is said to be hyperlipidemic state, cause hyperlipidemia. In the first and second trimester of pregnancy, there is a maternal fat store which ceases in the third trimester of pregnancy. But in general, it causes hyperlipidemia. Protein metabolism, even though the total body protein increased during pregnancy, the serum level of albumin and the serum level of the proteins are decreased during pregnancy. This is mainly because of the hemodilutions. The placenta concentrates the amino acids into the fetal circulation and transfer to the fetus for the fetal growth. Electrolyte and mineral metabolisms. During normal pregnancy, nearly 1,000 milliequivalent of sodium and 300 milliequivalent of potassium are retained. Although their total accumulation is elevated, their serum concentrations are diminished slightly. This is mainly because of the hemoconcentration in case of potassium and water retentions in case of sodium. Total and iodized magnesium concentrations also significantly lower during pregnancy. Thank you for watching. Don't forget to subscribe my channel to have more videos.